Colleagues, this is Chusanang PM Sebata. I'm doing a quick video. I'm trying to shorten my videos to under 10 minutes. Yeah, I'm just going through my thesis for having a case for shorting EDU, EDU. It's Oriental Educational Technology Group based in China. I'll just call it EDU. It makes my life easier. That's the ticker symbol for it. I started off with some technical analysis, which gave me a hint that this stock is a good candidate for shorting. I'll just go through the charts, but I won't spend much time on them. I want to focus a little bit on the fundamentals. This is the weekly chart for 5 years. You can see that this thing was sitting on the edge. Let me just expand there. This is my focus. The price was just sitting on this blue line, the ticking sign, and the dots, the parabolic star was getting very close. So we're close to a situation whether it was going to give to the upside or downside, but this one is more to the downside. Yes, there's an element of this being flat a bit, but the other charts told me otherwise. So I was very interested in having a better view of this as to what is really going on as a potential short, because the other indicators were telling me this is in the shorting zone. Sorry, did not intend to come up with that one. And this was my final chart. I'll deal with it. This is on the daily side. On the daily side, you can see that this moving average, the blue one and the red one, they are all in the same point and flat. So we've been consolidating, but this is likely to give any time. On the daily chart, it says the parabolic stars are below. So it's a little bit confusing between the weekly and the daily chart, but I'll usually go with the weekly. Something's not working with my charts. I'm trying to flip around, it's not going. Okay, then I'll just focus on the final chart. The final chart, when I did my analysis, just to jump forward, this white line here, you can see at 75. This is my intrinsic valuation. When I did my intrinsic valuation, I came with a value of 75 for this stock. It's currently trading, when I did this, it was trading at almost 109. There, just above that point. About 109, that's where it was. It was before the open of the market today. And yeah, my analysis was that it's going to drop to the intrinsic value is at 75. If it was to drop to that level, it would be doing about 36% drop on that. And I'm very optimistic that this will come to pass. So that's why I shorted this one when the market opened. This is when I actually did my analysis and shorting. That chart was taken a little bit later. It was around 110 when I did my move. But that may be. I'm not doing technical analysis. This was the chart when I was doing the relative strength comparison. Here I was doing relative strength to the S&P. What I found was that whenever this chart is heading upwards, it performs better than the S&P 500 SPX. When it's going down, it goes down quicker than the SPX. So whenever it's, whatever it's doing, is doing it more than the market. And this is consistent with its beta. When I look at the beta, you'll realize that yes, this is consistent because it's got a beta of about 1.48. This is the chart which I got when I was doing my analysis earlier in the morning. As you can see here, I started my analysis around the early mornings at 8, and the market, I'm in South Africa, the market opens around 3. So the last charts which I did was just these closing ones for something else, but most of the stuff was done in the morning. That's on the technical side. I'll do a special video on technicals later this coming month, during the later part of the month. And just to check some of the reports which I was looking at when I had done my 10 cars, and I realized that I'm interested in this stock. I wanted to see what's going on with this stock and build a thesis, whether it's valid one or one to pass. I like to come to this FinVis summary page because it's loaded with information. Starting at this end of the chart, I couldn't see anything which worried me. The PE is a little bit high, peg high, but yeah. But what I liked was that the debt, this company is next to nothing in terms of debt. It's not a very good sign when you want to short, but for the long term, it will be a good company. Because I also considered it will be a good play to have it in my portfolio. Some of these accounts, I can just short them when they are going down so that I reduce my cost basis when I eventually go long and keep them for some time. So I was happy with this scenario here. Earnings per share were great for the past year. Past 5 years, it's doing fine. Growth is great. 20% compounded in the past 5 years. Earnings per share in the 43 region for the last quarter. It's great. Here's what worried me. When I go to the return on asset, return on equity, return on investment, this was in the low teens, basically 10 and 11. And looking at the standard Chinese company, I would expect it to be on the region of 12, 13, so or even more, because my risk factor for China would be a little bit higher than the companies in the US. So that was why I was worried here, because my take when I saw these numbers first up was that this company might be destroying value, meaning its cost of capital and its cost of equity might be higher than its return on equity. That was the worrying, a major thing which I picked as a worry factor. Before I did my analysis, I thought this might be a challenge. It might look good because the revenue is growing and people are looking at it from that perspective and pumping up the stock higher, but there's an issue here. And also to compound the issue, the operating margin is very thin. At 8%, this is too low. There's not much safety, margin of safety that is really worrying. But the analysts are saying target price about 118, higher than where we were at 110. And my take is that we've really hit the top here. So I don't see it going there. But yeah, that let that be. Then the next part was performance. The stock has been performing very well. Year to date, it's doubled. Previous year, it did 55. So stock performance is great, but the fundamentals are worrying. This will not be a stock which I would pick for the long, to go long and call it one of my A stocks. It will be definitely a borderline stock, which I don't like keeping. I like to pick the best and live with the best. So on the fundamentals, this was my scenario. Everything else was fine, but the return on equity and return on investment and the operating margin were really worrisome. And looking at the report from the Street Quant Ratings, I like the idea that it compounded for the past 3 years. Price has moved 34% up. So when you invest in stocks like this, you know that you're going to make your money. If it's compounding at 34, you definitely beat most of the asset managers. These are the stocks which I like to get into. Revenues been growing well, so it's a growth company. I like that. But here comes the problem again. Net income, last quarter, negative. Earnings per share, last quarter, negative. 12 months back, net income, earnings, negative. 3 year compounding, it's compounding at about 1%. So this company, yes, it's growing revenue. Yes, the charts are doing fine, but it's not making money. Because these returns, I can almost make a claim that they are below inflation rate. So the company is growing, but it's not actually literally making money. That's what was worrying me. Yet its PE is way higher compared to its subsector and the S&P 500. So there is a disconnect in the fundamentals. The guys pushing the prices higher and the fundamentals are not talking the same language. I know it's a loved stock, but it's not a good stock currently. It's not making money, it's just growing revenue. And the charts are, the stock is getting higher, but I won't buy, bet on it being a good stock. You can see here, the target price is some one crazy 131. I've got it at 75, somewhere here. Not way there, that's where intrinsic value, I'm finding intrinsic value at 75. So this was the scenario which I got from my desktop analysis. I'll close all these tabs and go to an actual evaluation which I did. Let's take a look. And on this valuation, the key challenge which I had on the valuation, I was a little bit lazy reading through the 10K, 20F, not 10K, 20F on this scenario. The, I had not put any R&D and operating leases, but the worrying thing was on the effective tax. For the past 3 years, it's been inconsistent. One time it's at 19, it's at 16, 21, 30, so it's floating all over. I'm not even sure what the correct effective tax rate is. So I went with the marginal tax rate for China. The last one I could find was that it was 25%. The rest of the stuff, I did not really tweak it that much. Growth for the next 2 years, I kept it at 26. Currently it's 26.52. Next 3 years, I kept it at 25. And yeah. Pre-tax operating margin, I kept it at 10. It's close enough. It's 9.87 currently, so I maintained that. There's not much reinvestment, really. Risk-free rate, I used the most recent one. Then the cost of capital, I got it from this. I did a calculation for it on the other side. I'll explain it now. Sorry, wrong tab. I did not do heavy work. I just took the beta. I did not do an unlevered bottom up beta. I just took it from FinViz, standard 1.46, and the risk premium. This company operates in China only, so I went with the risk premium. This is a little bit oldish. I'll take it that it might be around 6.3 currently, but it's not really that is highly significant for my calculations. So that's where I got my risk premium and book value, and that one's coming from my input sheets. The ratings, I used the synthetic one. I was not going to go crazy looking for proper ratings in this Chinese company. That led me to getting this pre-tax cost of debt. If I could go and look at the synthetic. On the synthetic, it basically calculates the interest coverage ratio, then uses this lookup table to work out what the estimated cost of debt is. That's the number which eventually comes up here. I'm trying to work offline, so everything looks like it's going slowly for some reason. I don't know why. Oh man. This is the summary of the equity debt relationship to come up to cost to capital. So the cost of equity is about it's at 11. Remember that side we on FinViz we had it at about, let me just open it up to use exact figures. The cost of equity there was 11.5. Sorry, the return on equity was 11.5, and from my calculation, the cost of equity is 11.1. So it's really marginal. And I'm not saying my figures are 100% correct, so this can be bouncing either way higher than or lower than. So there is a potential they're blowing up at destroying value. On the equity side, the debt side is very low and insignificant, 0.5%. The cost of capital, including these two, we end up with 11. And from that table, return on investment is 10.2, which is definitely lower than my cost of capital. So technically, this company is losing value. That's why even that research analyst in the past year and the past quarter, the company was definitely bringing negative income and earnings per share. So putting all that together, I came up with a valuation of 74.76 compared to this 110 where it's currently trading. And my take is there is enough room for it to revert to the mean of intrinsic value of 75. And the charts are saying it's time for it's in the shorting zone. So that's why I took the action there. And yeah, my storyline, to put it basically, is that does not move based on, yeah, the other thing about this company, it doesn't move based on its fundamentals. Technically, its fundamentals are not that much. It doesn't shift a lot. Business model, once somebody puts their kids through a certain educational course, they don't shift them every day. So the revenues are a little bit sticky and consistent, and as they grow more revenue, they're going to end up increasing their income and margin. So this company is not one company which is supposed to have a serious beta like 1.4. It's supposed to be very low, the beta, in the region of 1.5, 0.5, or even less than 0.5. So the way it moves, it's inconsistent with the fundamentals. So this is a trader's chart. Somebody who wants to invest in this one should be aware of that. It's typically a company where one would do well trading it rather than as an investment. I've spoken about the tax issue, that it fluctuates a lot between 16 and 36. Here I was still saying likely to be destroying value. They are destroying value currently, but with the growth in revenue, they might end up stabilizing it. But it's not one of the best companies. The revenue is growing well, the chart is increasing well, but the margin is so small, and the return on equity and return on investment are almost the same as with the cost. So there's not much money to be made there. So that's my thesis on this one. It's a good candidate for shorting. And on the going long in future, I really doubt it. I'll just use it as a trading chart. When the whole market is going up because of its beta of 1.4, call it 1.5, one would rather just trade it on the up and get out. But it's not an investment type company. And yeah, that's my take. And also, I went further and did a little bit of some detailed work on the returns, because that's really sticky for me. When you're going to trade this company, make sure that you spend some time and look at what is the actual calculations for your return on equity and return on investment. After putting my inputs, I'll attach this spreadsheet, so if one wants to go into a little bit more detail, they can check it out. But what I found after adjusting my calculating my own invested capital using information from the previous year and the current year, because I look at whatever money was put into the company last year is the one which is generating the returns this year. It's not the usual calculation of return on equity where you are looking at this information from the same year. So using my adjusted return on invested capital, I came up with a 15% return compared with the cost, which is at about give or take 11. So the margin there is only about 4%, the difference. It's not much. but at least it's positive from my detailed calculations here. Return on equity, it's at 11. And that's the other one is also at 11, so there's not much difference there. So net-net, based on returns, this company is not doing much good. Last year, it lost the value, earnings per share were down, net income was down, negative. And I'm not seeing any difference because this is too close to call. If you are going to invest in something and your return on equity and return on investment is less than 2%, it's not that much of a candidate, but it's a good candidate for shorting. So that's why I went short on this one. And yeah, we'll keep looking at how things are going on with it, because my take is that I'm expecting a 36% drop in this company. This is supported by the evaluation here, intrinsic valuation, and also from the charts. When I looked at the charts, there's also Fibonacci retracements. Those who are good with the Fibonacci's, it comes smack on 68, and that's the one of these support levels here. We have this support level and some here, and yeah, there was one a little bit higher there, that 50% retracement. But the major one is this one at 61.8. So I don't see any problems with it collapsing to this level. Even the cloud is close enough there. And yeah, I'm convinced it's coming down there. And let's watch how it goes. That was my analysis for EDU, ticker symbol EDU, Chinese Educational Company. Thanks a lot. It's Pinkas Tuzanang Machilo Sebata. Bye-bye.